Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Okay, so we'd like to know about you guys before obviously the partnership started, before Fortress Media was established. If you could just tell us about your background, where you came from, your families, up until Fortress Media, then we'll get into that. So any one of you can start.
Can start from varsity.
You don't need to tell us about how many you are, where you're from.
Okay, my name is Edwin Chibanga. I'm the first born of three boys. I was born here in Lusaka, UTH. In the early 90s, we moved to Botswana, so I did my primary school and my secondary school in Botswana. And then I did my varsity at Reno in Namibia. I actually studied economics, so I have a bachelor's degree in economics. And along the way, my dad decided to move back to Zambia. This was somewhere around 2006. So I moved back with him. So it was just the two of us for about a year, staying here in Zambia. And the rest of the family eventually followed, but at the same time, it felt like I was waiting for varsity. I decided that we didn't want to work for someone, so we opened a family business, an IT company. So I spent a good 3-4 years managing an IT company that dealt with fleet management and things like computing. Actually introduced fleet management to Zesco and several other ministries, the Ministry of Local Government. I also went with a solution that helped sell to them. And then along the way, I met my wife I didn't meet her then. I've known her from childhood, but then we were separated and then eventually we met again. And we dated for a while, then got married, and had a son. Then my wife had to move to Kenya to further her studies. She was there for a couple of years, and after so much pressure, she was pressuring her, hey, you need to come here, come and stay here, this is not working here, they're too far, not, not. So I moved to Kenya for a while. Me and my son followed her, and we stayed there for a while. During the same period, that's when we started a company with one of my friends and my brother called Ethan Kane. That was basically my introduction to photography. So with that platform, we were doing photos, making a bit of noise on social media and so on. But with my move to Nairobi, the company kind of slowed down a bit. And then during that period, me and Malekano started having conversations. Basically, he was forcing me to come back home. Like, hey, you better come back home. Come back home, let's do this. Let's do something. Come back home, let's do something. So one December holiday, I snuck out of Kenya, told my wife, hey, we'll be back after Christmas, and never went back. It was hectic. She was disappointed for a while, but I was like, you're in Nairobi and you're not here forever. So I need to go back home and make sure that our foundation is proper. So eventually she had the students, she let it be, and me and my son. Then we moved back to Zambia. And this was now 2014. So we started?
Yeah,
so that was 2014. The market was basically ripe from how we saw it. We had photographers on the market, we had media people on the market, but then nobody at the time had branded themselves as a company. A lot of people were just individuals, just Edwin doing photos or Maliq doing photos, and nobody was really doing it as a company. And we saw this as a niche that we could basically use for Fortress. But before I go further, I didn't let Maliq also
introduce himself. Yes.
Okay. Trying to think where to start from. First of all, my wife is here, so thank you for coming, baby. I love you too. I'm number 4 of 8 children. My full name is Malekano Mwanza. Maliq was given to me by some Arabic friends that we had. Basically, my growing up, the first 10 years of my life were pretty good at everything. yeah, it was pretty good. But I think after that, that's the time around about when MMD and them guys were coming on the scene and whatnot. FTJ won the election, and then that tried to venture out into some things. And one day you are in a house with everything, and then next day you wake up, you're in Mandembo. And so after that, it was really a rough time. Got to grade 8, around about then, and had to change a bit of schools. So for me, I knew life on the other side, I think from that point onwards, because I had to pay for my school fees from grade 10 through to when I finished university. I went to the University of Zambia. I have a Bachelor of Science in Natural Resource Management. Whatever that means, I've never known. because after I left university, I think I really tried to push hard. I got myself into really good spaces, tried to work really hard. Found myself at a young age being in management with one of USAID's biggest projects that they had at that time. Found myself designing and managing a whole European Union project. I found myself doing a lot of project audits for Oxfam. So I got to the point where somehow I had put a lot of hard work in it, and I got it going. And in terms of work, it's probably a young man at my age is what they would have loved. Probably less, because we're sitting in management, making all these decisions, and you have all these things, and you're traveling, and everything's happening. And it was a really good job, and I was very happy with helping people and seeing people's lives change, and designing all these projects. And basically at the point where people are thinking, ish, this guy, how does he think? And at that point, the whole time I kept on thinking, have a good job, it gives me money, I got married, had a son, and it still put the question in me that this guy that has been born, when he grows, what am I going to leave for him? I can't leave him my degree, I can't leave him my job, I can't leave him all these privileges that I have at this point of work. So then my initial self, the Tamanga self, because I literally Tamanga'd my whole university life, I literally Tamanga'd from grade 10 to be able to pay for my fees. And so I did all kinds of odd jobs, from cleaning my school toilets to selling books to anything that could be sold, and helping wherever I could. So I started thinking, saying, I've come through all this, but this guy, I need to leave a legacy for him and his other siblings. And so about that point that I decided, it was a year before I actually quit my job, that I said, hey, I'm going to start preparing to leave this job. And so after that, where I used to work, they have another huge USIB project. I did the proposals and whatnot, but they were constantly worried about was within the proposals and everything, I was not including myself. You know, it becomes natural. If you're an NGO, you know the next proposal, you want to make sure the first position that is secured is yours. You know you're getting paid. So in this one, we'll need my department to do this, my department to do this, and my department to do this. I secured jobs for everybody else by myself, because I was preparing to really leave. I was like, Muna, you need to come back, you need to do this. I think the market is ripe. I think we can do this. I think we have the necessary skills. And basically, I don't know if there's anything else I need to know about. I've got two kids, two boys. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So you have both worked for, you were previously employed, obviously, before you went into Fortress Media, and you had family businesses. So what prompted you to leave an existing business and start something different?
On the inside, I've always been a creative. IT is not really a creative field. Yeah, so basically, I've been a creative inside. I was never satisfied doing IT. And then when I had the chance to leave for Nairobi, then I resigned and wrote a letter to the company. It was a family business, but it's still a company. So I wrote a letter saying I'm resigning as the managing director. And that's how I left for Nairobi. And when he started bugging me to come back, I was like, okay, that's an opportunity for me to go back, but also go back in a different field, do something that I really love deep down. So that made it easier for me to come and just get into photography and to meet him.
Everyone knows he takes like really good pictures. His finishing of the pictures is something really great. I was really good with videos. In my work, actually, I ended up taking over the media department every time because I had a really fine eye for detail and I was good with my video. And I think that's what made our partnership even want to work even more, because media, you have video and you have photography, and you have two people who are really gifted in two areas. And we were sure we wanted to do what we love, wanted to be creative, do it with fun, and make lots of money.
Okay, so it's very clear that you were talented in the videography and he was the picture man. So tell us about Fortress Media. I know you mentioned that you only had two cameras when you started in 2014, and obviously we see more cameras now of the very expensive lenses. And you have a workforce of about 15 staff. So if you could just tell us how that all transitioned.
Well, when we decided to make Fortress, the number of things that we deliberately decided. First, we said we're going to have a company. We're going to brand ourselves. We were not going to come on the scene as individuals. And so, consequently, now we're a mix. He does lots of video and lots of editing. I take lots of pictures. I hate editing.
yeah, so I get to suffer.
Yeah.
So at the beginning, was this the two of you guys?
Yes. At the beginning, it wasn't just the two of us. At the beginning, we started out basically the four of us. The two other gentlemen. One is still around, but he's more on the silent side. The other one broke off completely. But what we said is we're going to form a media company in Zambia, and we're going to be the first company that is going to brand and really bring media to the fore as a branded company. And we set out with a vision to become the number one production house in Zambia. So a lot of other media companies get in the business and they become agencies and they do all sorts of things. We said our niche was going to be producing really good pictures, producing really good videos, producing really good motion graphics. And so we set out, basically the four of us, and we were privileged. We have two guys who have been with us through the journey. I had Muzo, who's on the camera now, and from Ethan Cage, he had AK. And so we said, let's start this. And the guys, well, they cut from a really rare cloth because they believed in us so much, and they believed in us making it so much, that they said, we're going to start with you. And there was no salary for anybody. And they speak with us now, they're on salary, of course. And yeah, they contribute to the tax base as well. And yeah, and basically, that is where Fortress started from the desire to bring on the market a really different product when it comes to photography, video, and motion graphics.
Okay.
Then one of the things we also looked at was that we needed to make sure we delivered faster than everybody. So we, every time we got a job or we had something to do, our aim was to make sure we're producing quality, but also faster than what people are doing on the market. So we made that our angle as well, to make us basically more attractive to our client base as well.
Okay, so on partnerships, I'd like to learn about how you've managed to sustain yourself. Obviously, you mentioned someone fell off. It's not often that we hear, you know, I'm going to start a company and I'll start it with someone else. It's usually I'm starting the company. How have you sustained your business? Because obviously, having started with two cameras, you started making the profits started coming, and obviously one of you must have said, let's reinvest in the business. Are you always on the same page, like, yeah, let's go ahead, you know, or, you know, you have to deal with, no, I don't think that's a good idea. So how do you just resolve all this?
To start with, I think some years back, Mr. Mutati said something about Zambian companies. Zambian companies, when you start a company, you want to start with your family, 100% you own the shares, and you're making nothing. Instead of owning 5% of a company, that's making something. So, like, with that at back of my mind, I've always thought partnerships are something that's worth. Even if you're getting 1%, if that company is making $2 billion, you're getting 1% of it. But then this Zambian thing of, no, I want to own my company, I want to just be the only one because only I know how to run this company, I think that's a wrong notion. So with that in mind, I've always believed in partnerships. And then partnerships are almost like a marriage. When you have a wife, you have to compromise on certain things. And if you put the marriage first, then whatever you're doing is towards that. So even with the company, whatever decision we have to make is for the brand to sustain itself. And the fact that we also have families, meaning we can't be greedy with our decisions. We can't make money and think, let's go buy cars, or let's go do this. But we're thinking, this company needs to be here when these kids are older. But this company needs to put these children through school, through university. So with that at the back of your mind, there's no way that you can be making wrong decisions. Even if I'm thinking, no, I need to do this, if Malik says, no, but that won't work because I think this, then it gives you time to think about it and then it'll work. So I think at the base of all partnership, communication is key. Just like a marriage, you have to communicate and you have to understand where the other person is coming from. And then also you still have to have your vision. If your vision is intact, then whatever you're deciding is headed towards that vision.
Yeah, and I think the other issue in terms of partnerships, I think a number of partnerships fail because from the onset, the reason behind the partnership is not very well put together. What am I saying? We got into a partnership because we knew we could leverage on each other's strengths. My strengths were not his strengths, and his strengths were not my strengths. Although now we probably can take pretty good pictures, both of us. We can take very good videos, both of us. I still have to edit. You know, so he gets to suffer. And at the end of the day, it's about leveraging on each other's capabilities. If you get a partner and you're all good in the same thing, you'll probably end up having a huge fight and clashing a lot. And then the other issue, I think it's about knowing what you want to achieve and knowing that we're working together to achieve this. And we know that if we're not in a partnership, it will take us the next 10 years to do this. If I had gone ahead on my own and he had gone ahead on his own, chances are that we wouldn't have grown at the rate at which we've grown, probably not made as much money as probably we've made. We were stronger and we actually moved faster towards achieving what we intended to achieve in 2014. 2015, we again put our heads to it and we had what we needed to achieve, because we know the final goal where we want to get. And I think those become very key in striking partnerships. Being able to know that each one brings a unique set of skills and ability. Like I go out a lot. I do a lot of the marketing and a lot of schmoozing clients and lying to them and, you know.
Yeah,
and I go back and I'm like, Eddie, this is the lie that I told you. Better make it work, man.
So who does the more? what's the compromising? With a couple, you know, there's always one who does what's the compromise.
It depends. Like you said, if it's in terms of talking to clients or being in traffic the whole day, nothing falls on him.
Oh, okay.
In terms of a lot of sleepless nights at the office, and that will fall on me because I'm on the production side of things. So that's the balance that we have going.
But so
if projects get heavy, then we're also busy.
So what's the one thing that you're most proud of with regards to Fortress Media? Something when you look back, you say, yeah, this was the moment for you.
Yeah, I think that's a bit tricky because I knew you'd ask a question like this. I tried to think about it, and I'm like, there's so many incredible things that happened. I think one of them when Maliq came and said the office of the first Republican president called for us to come shoot something at the house. I was like, wow, that's great.
Yeah, what one?
That's great. I'm like, let's go. And then we were at KK's house and we're filming there. And we're like, wow. So many wonderful things that happened in the 2 years. It's hard to actually have one thing to be super proud of. Maybe I can say us being still here is one thing that I'm proud of.
Awesome.
Maliq? Yeah, there have been a lot of very, very high moments that we look back and we're very proud of. When we got our first big clients as a bank, we kept them through. We kept them and they kept us through the whole year. And we were the first media house that they had kept through the whole year because their standards were so high. Every Zambian company that would go there, they'd kick them out and go back to get stuff from South Africa. They get another Zambian company, 2 months, they kick them out, go back, get stuff from South Africa. And now, for us, it was really great because they picked us and they kept us. And what happened is now, their group office in South Africa started giving us jobs to produce at the same level as the guys in SA, at the same level as the guys in Egypt, at the same level as the guys in Kenya. And for a Zambian firm to be in that place, we were very proud of ourselves. I remember Dr. Kaunda thought we were actually not a Zambian company. And so after we set up and we shot and everything was on point, everything was moving very well at the end of it all, because this particular video was going to those for some Brazilian client. And so he calls us and says to us, "So where are you boys from?" And we tell him, "We're from within Zambia, we're from within Lusaka." Then he looked up at both of us and he said, "Come," and he actually prayed for us and he said lots of blessings on us, because that was the first time an assignment of that nature was being done by Zambians. And these are not Zambians who are the old guys who have been running cameras, these are young guys. And so I think that was a really high moment for us. I think our other high moment was was basically after we ran the year with this one big client who is a bank, and then this year begins and we're like, okay, what if another major house goes there? Is there anybody who can do better than us? And we're trying to plan and make them happier and all that. And then the year started and we're with them again, and so for us that's a huge success. To be able to keep a client that consistent is not easy in our business, because there's always a new guy coming up. There's always a youngster coming up and trying to do what you're doing, but doing it better. There's always that guy who comes back from the US, who has the new software, the new water,
bigger camera,
messing up everything up. And so ours is to really improve every time. And that also has been a highlight, where we're able to improve every time. Like, we're always able to beat ourselves. We think we're really proud of that. But there've been like lots of moments. Of course, 2015, the election, and we were privileged to be able to shoot President Edgar Lungu and be able to do stuff for State House. That was another highlight that we were like, oh, okay, wow. I mean, at that point, we did not have any political inclination. We were not doing that or raising the fist or showing fingers. Or doing any of that sort, but for people to genuinely say, hey, these guys, this talent, and if we're looking for this level of production, we need to call them. And we think that was, yeah, so we've had a lot of moments that we're proud of.
Awesome. Financing. When you started your company, how did you finance the company? Did the money come from your pockets? Did you get a loan?
There were two cameras. That's all.
That was it.
That's basically how we started.
Now, basically, you see, when I did not have my job for a long time, so it was precisely 2 years, and so I didn't expect to come up with a huge pension, but thank God within that, I bought one small camera, and he had another camera. I had my laptop, he had a laptop, and we said, this kind of business that we're doing, first of all, we can't walk into a bank and ask for any money. Nobody's going to give us that money, so we're going to start. And that's basically how we started. And I can tell you that it was rough because there were, for us, there were no safety nets. There was nothing. It was, you go in and shoot a picture, you charge for that picture, and that is your income. And so we started growing it from that point. People come and treat our clients correctly. We try and give them an experience. We try and keep the corporate face. We try and be professional. We don't have many, but we still act professional and give the client what they need. And slowly, clients started building confidence, and they started paying more. And then...
when they're paying more, you started charging more.
Whoa, we started charging more. But... Yeah.
Okay.
Because people then realize that I'm paying this much, but the quality is worth this money. And we, in terms of marketing, we decided to use what was the free marketing platform at that point, which is what we're still big on right now. I think we're going to be big on it for a lot of years to come, which was social media, because we did not have any money to hire a marketing person, though now we've hired one. We did not have any money to pay on any platform or TV or anything. We did not have that money, so we decided to use social media, and we knew that most of our target client, at least had the majority were on social media. And so we went big on social media, and so for the people that came to Fortress the beginning years, when we see on social media and we come to Fortress-ish, now it's different. Yeah, now we're trying to
And what would you say was the biggest challenge that you've had to go through as a company, and how did you overcome that?
You overcame it by just one step at a time. You have one client, you charge the client, the money comes in, we split it amongst everybody at the company, so Malik gets his share, I get my share, Muzo gets his share, Eki gets his share, and we were going like that for a while. And the more we were charging, the more the share will go. The more we would share, until eventually we reach a point where we say, you know what, now when the money comes in, let's take it to the bank. We can't continue sharing the money like this because it's not progressive for the company. So eventually now we started banking the money, and we're able now to say, okay, no, we're going to start you on a salary, you know, this you get this much a month, and so on. So I think for me that was one of our biggest challenges. The other challenges for me weddings. I think wedding clients, because we cover lots of weddings. Those are the most challenging clients that we have. Dealing with brides can become a bit hectic during the day of the wedding and after the wedding. Where's this picture? Well, you guys can take that picture, and so on, and this is like that.
One of the biggest challenges we faced was the money aspect. I remember this one time. I was driving home in the office the following day, needed to follow up some plans, needed to get air time, and I needed gas in the car to be able to go there. And then my wife sent me a text like, we don't have milk, we don't have bread, and the baby needs ABCD. And at that particular time, I had 50 kwacha, and I called Eddie. I was like, Muna, this is the situation, I need some money. He's like, you know, my brother came to get me and dropped me at work. And so, what do you do with a 50 kwacha? You need to get milk, you need to get bread, you need to get airtime, you need to get fuel. And so I remember parking by the gas station, and I just had to pray, like, God, you have to work this out with us. This is really tough for us. And so, yeah, but we tried to break down the 50 kwacha, bought a bread, a pint of milk, 20 kwacha gas, 5 kwacha airtime, went home, still smiled. And so we had a couple of those times. And I think during that time, that was the most trying time for us, because then, for me at that time, I would actually get home and I'll probably buy a newspaper looking for tenders in there, and there'd be a job opening at an organization that actually once approached me wanting to hire me from where I was. And I was like, should I apply? You know, and that, yeah, I think that was for me, that if I go back, that was the most challenging time. The rest, really, we managed to live through.
So we'll open it up to the audience. They obviously have questions for Fortress Media.
So I think I'll start off firstly by saying I love these guys, no homo. they're really good friends in the industry, and I'm a PR person, specifically digital PR. And I like that Maliq pointed out your use of social media to market. And I mean, even in my work, I've had to notice that it's pretty a niche industry in Zambia, and a lot of the big corporate brands are just managing to sell onto it. I guess my question is, from what I've noticed and the way that you've marketed yourself, using celebrities, using social media, and just using the viral aspect of marketing to brand yourselves, have you had any challenge? Because now I hear, you know, there's political clients, and then there's the banks, the corporate clients. Have you had any challenge in switching from what I would say is a social brand perspective to more corporate, more serious, more corporate representation? And if you haven't, how have you done that effectively? Because clearly you have.
I'd probably like to take that. First and foremost, when we started out, our biggest target was always the corporates. That was always our target. But we needed to get their attention. And to get their attention, we understood that people don't buy from companies. People buy from people. So you need to get the attention of individuals. You need to get the attention of people. And these people have a social life. And part of their social life is on a social network. And so that was our strategy, and that's why we went all up there. And we were privileged to be able to have all these celebrities. And the interesting part is, a lot of people actually think most of the celebrities were shot for free, but for most of them it was paid shoots, and we could then ask them, can we use your picture, you know, for part of our buzz, for part of creating the experience of hashtag enter the fortress, because even a CEO at a bank, they still listen to Oliver Mtukudzi. And if I get Oliver Mtukudzi, say Oliver Mtukudzi entered the fortress, because the CEO listens to Oliver Mtukudzi, they'll be like, I don't like these guys now. Then we have his attention. Then we go in and sell our corporate bits. And because of the nature that we do for both the politicians and the corporates, we feel it's not right for us to bring a lot of their work to social media, because they have brands to protect. We do not want to misrepresent their brands. And we do, for the politicians, we do not want to bring out everything about them. We don't want to be the reason that somebody posted a certain picture of them and their family and whatnot. So we only use what we think is necessary and relevant to be able to market. And because of that understanding of why we use social media, it has helped us grow in the background our corporate base as well as the other other aspects.
How do you effectively get to market yourselves in social media? What are the tricks you use? That's the first one. The second one, I was very interested in knowing how you manage as a partnership, because there have been a lot, failure rate is high among partnerships in Zambia. So I want to know, is it, how have you kept together? Are you bound by certain statutes using a lawyer, or is your partnership bound by goodwill towards each other?
We don't have any partnership agreement, other than the fact that we know that at PACRA we have 50-50, he gets the other 50, I get my other 50. But more than that, more than papers, more than anything, I think it's an issue of understanding what the vision is and having that common vision that you want to achieve, which is what we have. And so when work comes in, I know my bits, and we divided this way from the very beginning. I do the admin stuff, I do the PR stuff, I talk to clients, I show up at clients' events, I try to make our clients feel good and do whatever I can to get the clients, and I do my bits in terms of filming and photography. He's in charge of production. So we have 15 members of staff. Of the 15 members of staff, only 4 are non-production staff. So those 4 under me, but the rest of the 11 are under his charge. And so he drives the engine. He's there like, guys, you need to get this to the client. For me, like I said, I go there, I like the client, I tell the client, you're gonna have this tomorrow when you wake up. And I go back and like, yeah, the client needs this tomorrow when we wake up. And we have to put in that work. And we have no option. So we spend nights on end in the office. And we, because we both understand our common vision, we're both, our bond is based on achieving the common goal. And achieving and having those things in common, like we have children, we need to leave something for them when we leave. And so we try to lead by that. We know we want to create a monster media company. We know our financial targets. We know what we need to get in terms of our market share. And those aspects are what keeps us together, because we know that when we break up, it's gonna take longer for us to get there. Besides, we have a cool name and nobody wants to lose Fortress, man. Do a Chimtengo photography.
The first thing, like you mentioned, is about people. So you have to appeal to people, to the Zambian, to the person who grabs the phone and logs onto Facebook. You have to appeal to that person. And so how do we do that? It's basically by who we target to be in some of the pictures that we use to promote ourselves. And also how creative we get with the pictures. I don't know if you've been to our page, but I think if you were to compare, well, we actually have some of the best pictures in the country, basically, in terms of what we have on our Facebook. So I think that is that's our biggest trick, producing high quality images, creative images, something that somebody, that if when you open a page, you look at it, you're like, wow, this girl's beautiful, and maybe this picture's beautiful, or wow, look at how my piece is looking in this picture. And if you compare a Fortress picture of a person, that would take, let's say, for example, I'll give you one piece. If you compare previous pictures, you might see a difference. You're like, wow, this Fortress image looks a bit different. This image looks maybe better, or it looks more clearer, or the detail is different in this picture. And those are some of the tricks that we've utilized in terms of how do we use social media to market our brand.
Tag. Just tag. If the person is in a friend list, tag them. Because what will happen is that will show up on their newsfeed or on their timeline, and people who know them will see that. So even if they are not interested, somebody else who they know who's interested is going to see that. And so you keep pushing that. And when you have an opportunity to shoot somebody, like I think one of the first people we shot was Lulu Hangala, who has Twitter of over 20,000 followers and another 30-something thousand followers on Facebook. You know that when we push this and tell her, push this, tell them it's enter the fortress, you know you have an average of 20,000 people, you have an average of 30,000 people, an average of 50,000 people on social media who that particular picture is going to pop somewhere. It's going to, you know, even if they're just scrolling, they're going to see it. And because it's high quality, they'll be like, wait, eish, banawama. And then they're like, then who took this picture? So then they come over to our page, and then they get our details. And basically, that's about it. You need to, the biggest trick is to have that something different and tag.
Tag.
Yes, and make sure your brand is seen. We want everyone to see Fortress. Like, when we go for shoots, we wear Fortress. Our pictures, you see a Fortress in the corner. We knew some photographers who never used to do that. Now they do that. They've been in the game longer than we've been. And now they're also learning, like, hey, this issue is about branding. Basically because the problem we notice is that as individuals, they make a certain amount of money, but they can only make as much because they can only do as much. They go take the picture, go edit. Me, I just go take the pictures and like, hey, edit. Here we go. I took the pictures. You know? You make a plan, okay? You take the pictures, you edit, or you'll be like, hey, AK, I took the pictures. Do something. And so that becomes a niche in itself. And then you have the whole group, every member of staff, tagging whoever they know. And can you imagine if I did something and tagged everyone here, and everyone here tagged everyone that they know? Do you know how viral that would go in an instant? That's the power of social media.
Absolutely. Congratulations, guys. I mean, I love the symbiosis. I've been feeling it buzzing. I've got a light bulb moment, stolen an idea already. I guess that's the way it goes with these things. And I hope that we continue to gel and grow. And I know that we've realized there's a captive area we're not tapping in terms of our businesses as well. I mean, separate, more technical, more in the healthcare, is engineering. So all those things come in because most people don't realize. And you know, the branding side of things that you're talking about, how do I brand a drug which goes into a patient, or you know, all those things, but at least the benefits that come out from it can be explored in terms of ideas and everything else like that. So definitely really, really like that. And I've been touched. I lost that on the free prize. One person, not happy with her, but I'll work on that later. But yeah, no, congratulations, and may you continue to grow, and we'll support the growth as we go.
You're one of the partners of Fortress. I thought maybe you're just one of the workers. I think that the way you treated me, I think it's a testament to how a lot of us Zambians, when you step into a company, the CEO wants you to feel that he is the CEO. I think you treat people the way people should treat anybody else. I'm impressed with that. Even I think the output of their work, I must say, I went in with my family. We wanted, I think 15 pictures. He did a lot. I went with my two twin babies, very small. It was a lot of work. The kids were all over. I think the guys worked very, 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 very hard. When the work came out, we ended up, I think, getting about paying for 60 pictures. So I think when you say, when people started paying little, they paid more because the work was so good. I'll end with a question. I've been to a lot of companies or startups for Zambians where, I'll give you an example. I went to a salon, a baby's place salon. The setup was excellent. You could see that the owner, the idea of having a salon for babies was there. But come to the employees, the other people who were now delivering the service, you could see that the owner has not drilled in the vision of how he wants the clients to be treated. How do you guys do that? How do you translate U2's vision? Fine, you have the vision, but to your so many, I think that you're saying you have about 15 employees. If it's pictures, how do you ensure that they do the quality work? How do you translate that vision?
I think for starters, I think it has to do with leading by example. One of our biggest clients is this bank. Now, there's something about the two people that we basically directly deal with, the head of marketing and the CEO of that particular bank. The one thing that we learned was the CEO of that bank drills the strategy of the bank to the most basic person within the structures. He gets down like that. Now, I'm saying this in comparison because we had another bank client before this particular one, and they were a whole lot harder to work with because it's like the CE has a vision and the head of marketing has a vision and the marketing manager also has a vision, and then these just get to confuse you when you want to deliver. So you deliver work, the CE is like, excellent, this is what I needed, and the head of marketing comes and says, no guys, this is not what I wanted, okay? And then you try and balance the two. Then the marketing manager, who is supposed to be in charge of making sure you get your paycheck, goes like, I'm not really sure, you guys need to redo this work. And basically, from working with that, that was like our almost first corporate client. We did very small works for within 2014. And so what we got to learn was, if you're gonna be head of any organization and the vision carrier, you need to lead by example. You need to get down, you also need to get dirty. You need to show the people that are working with you that this is how it's done. And so you need to get there, you need to get the camera. You need to know if it's a client, for example, like yourself, you know that they have a lot, there's children and there's whatnot. You know, who's the more patient one? Who loves kids here? Who's the Sunday school teacher? And that's the one we get to shoot that. I would think, hey, it's this kind of musician like that. Who's more patient with dealing with people who are bossy and a bit boasting nanjala? We know exactly who to assign to that job. And it's a daily process of drilling the vision into the staff. I don't think that ever ends, because every time we have gone to this one particular client to film anything for them, every time the CE keeps drilling their values, he keeps drilling their principles. Now we know them like we work for the bank.
And like you mentioned, it's an ongoing activity. You can't just drill your vision into your staff and then step back. It's something that you have to go through constantly, if not daily, weekly, monthly, go through it. For us, it's a lot of headbutting. We at loggerheads sometimes, the guys, like, oh, why don't you do it like this or do it like that? But all that builds the team, and also in the process, I think also builds ourselves, helps to affirm our visions in ourselves as well, as we're trying to make sure that everybody understands the direction that we are going.
You bridge the gap between being creatives and being business people. You find a lot of times you start a business because you love something. You guys love photography. Maybe someone here loves IT, they love accounting. But how do you manage to make it work being a photographer and keeping a business running? How do you maintain, or how do you manage to keep on doing what you love to do instead of being an admin person?
Creative images and creative products. And I've seen that, these guys, I see what they're trying to do. And if we were to take this, what they're trying to do, it might go with our strategy for marketing this year. And then how do we as a company maintain our creativity or improve or work on ourselves? As we do a lot of personal projects, personal in terms of we don't have a client for it, but we call, say, put together a photo shoot and say, let's try shooting something like this. And then we shoot that. And then from that we learn new things. And we meet up and say, how can we get this image to look like this and that and so on. So as individuals and as a company, you need to take some time out from your corporate side and say, how do we improve on ourselves? And I think that's the advice that we are trying to do.
We understand that we are in the business of being creative. Meaning when we stop being creative, we stop being viable in terms of a business, because what people come to buy is the creativity. So at any given point, when people come to you have a bakery and people come to buy bread, and every time they buy the bread is fresh. The moment that you start making stale bread or giving them bread that is not fresh, it's very easy. It's very easy for the client to look for the next bakery with a fresh bread. And that's from a business point of view, we don't want to get there. And so that is why every time we push ourselves, we've made friendships across Africa with other photographers who we think have been in the game for a long time, and their work is out there. So we talk to guys who shoot for BBC, we talk to guys who shoot for CNN, we talk to guys who shoot for National Geographic, and so that helps also keep the creativity, because you look at somebody else's work who's been in the game and they've been a photographer for years, and they've learned exactly how to tweak everything that we are probably still learning, and that keeps it going. And in terms of the concepts, we have to keep our eyes open every time. We have to keep our eyes to figure out what will wow our next customer, what is going to wow our next person, and things like that. And so we then do what Edwin was saying. We have to set up, we have to practice on our own. We keep practicing and getting better, so that when we meet the next client, that client shouldn't feel, they give me the same stuff that they gave the other client. We want the next new client to feel, hey, you gave me better than those guys, huh, I'm special. And if that client comes back, we give them something better than we gave them at the beginning, and they're like, wow, you guys can do this. And then so even the confidence of the client increases, which automatically has to have, you need to have your admin in place. You are forced to have your admin in place, because if your admin is not in place, then you're going to get messed up, and then you're going to lose all the clients, and then now what?
Looking at how photography is a fast-growing business right now in the country, we have, you know, so many different people in the media world. How have you managed to protect your brand as Fortress Media? You know, we get a lot of copycats here and there. How have you managed to protect your brand? What is it that sets you apart? What is it that makes you different? Why should I come to you? And number two is, looking back, I think you've been around for like 2 years. Looking back 2 years ago, what is the one thing about entrepreneurship that you wish you understood before? I'm asking because, you know, I'm 11 months old in my business, and I get, you know, very, very tough situations, and sometimes it's really hard. You know, it's moments when you're at a gas station and you have 50 kwacha and you're thinking bread and milk, or you're thinking my girls in school. It gets complicated. So looking back 2 years ago, what is the one thing about entrepreneurship that you wish you understood then that would have made things a little different for you now? And maybe number three, if, let's say, I got into photography, how much money do you think I would make?
The way to keep ahead of competition is to always create new stuff, always be creative, always, that's the one thing they can't copy from you, stuff that you have for the future. They only copy what you've already done. But like we've said, for us, once we do something, we're done with it, we move on to the next thing. And there are a lot of mushrooming photographers, but there are also a lot of other established photographers who we found in the game. And for us, it's to get our share of the market. And we're aggressive about that, and we're going to get our share of the market. If they want, let them also get their share of the market. The market is there. Everyone is there to get their share. And we understand that we need to get our share. And we know, we've mapped out, this is supposed to be our share. Period. And yeah. So we're going to get our share. And to get our share, this is what our client wants, and this is what we're going to give our client, and keep our share. So there are a number of other mushrooming photography companies that actually we came and worked for Fortress, and they thought, we know their secret. And they go out there, and yeah, we're smiling at them, and they're our boys, there's nothing much we can do. We love them with the love of the Lord. The one thing on entrepreneurship that I personally learned, I'll let Eddie say whatever, what part he's learned, but for me, the one thing that I wish somebody would told me, and I wish somebody had prepared me, was the fact that your first year was going to be very rough. I wish someone had told me that. I wish someone had told me that you're going to get to points where you will completely run out, but you have to keep going. I wish somebody had told me that the most important thing is your vision. And you get a lot of detractors along the way, people telling you like, yeah, this is not working, and I just not go back for work. Like, yeah, and you get a lot of people like, ish, my picture, my name was in a drama. In dramas and gads, I mean, my bang up my picture. And I wish somebody had told me that I was going to encounter all these things. But unfortunately, I realized that in entrepreneurship, everyone has their own journey. And you have to learn to take your journey as an individual. Just the way everybody has a unique fingerprint, every entrepreneur has their own path that they'll have to lead. But within moving in that path, the one thing that has to be consistent is your vision and going towards to meet the vision and making sure every other issue that comes up is a learning point. How much are you going to make as a photographer? I don't know how much you make as a photographer, but as a media company, you will probably make 1.8 million kwacha a year.
I'm changing.
The past 2 years, something I wish I knew coming up in this industry was the fact that not every opportunity is a blessing for your brand or for your company or for you. Along the way, people would come to us and say, "Ah, Fortress, I want you to come in and do this with us," and we'd be so excited. And like, this looks like something we should get involved in. And then along the way, you get your fingers burnt, and it doesn't work out, and you've wasted resources on it, or you go to a partnership without realizing that there are actually hidden costs behind delivering the product or the service at the end of the day. So I wish that, well, this is something basically that I've learned now after actually going through it. At the start of our journey, we were just like, opportunity, let's go do it. Oh, this, let's go do it. Oh, these guys want sponsorship, let's go do it. Oh, these guys want to partner with us, let's go do it. And then at the end of the day, you realize your workload increases and the benefits are almost minimal. And this is something that I have learned in the past 2 years.
I'm so happy to have to listen to you guys. I follow you a lot on social media, so mine is just one small basic question. I believe in the power of the name. One Fortress. You know, my friends and I have deliberated over your name for a while now. So thank God I'm here to actually ask you, why Fortress?
Name should be global. It should be, when people hear it, it should have a ringing sound. It should be easy to remember. And we wanted to have something that was the exact thing was something that would be out of space. Like if you're out of space and you put a logo down there, you'd be like, yes, that's Fortress, you know. And so when we're coming up with a name, we say we need to find something that will signify strength, that our clients will be secure when they get Fortress. When you come to take a picture of Fortress, you'll be sure that this is going to be a good picture. One of our guys, AK, is on the copper belt shooting for one of our clients, their food chain store. And the one thing is, they started out with Fortress. Then along the way, they started to experiment. And their words, when they were coming back, well, basically, they were like, no, you guys know, it was really hard because we couldn't have the same confidence and we couldn't find the same strength in the other guys that we were hiring. You guys, we know that this Fortress is here, we don't need to worry, the pictures are going to be good, period. And so that is exactly what we had when we had the name before we started out. And so that's how our Fortress came about. We wanted a strong place, and we both have very strong Christian roots, and we're Christians, and so we we wanted that name that would signify a very strong place, and it just became, we tried every word that meant strength. That was it. We had Forte, whatnot. When we got to Fortress, like, it should be Fortress. And when we went to register, the first time they denied, they you can't be Fortress, because there's another company, it's something, the Fortress and whatnot. Then went again and argued our case, and they said, no. There's another church which has got something, Fortress, God, and so you can't do this. And we went back, got that name, looked at it, and looked at what we're doing, and went back and argued it out until they gave us the name Fortress, because it was that important to us. We want you to feel strong. We want you to feel secure. We want you to have every confidence. When Fortress is around, you shouldn't worry about anything. When the client gives us work, the client shouldn't panic that they're gonna have any bad thing. They know that, hey, it's Fortress handling this. They know their business. They go to bed and sleep. They wake up the following morning, the work is done. They look at it like, exactly what I wanted plus more. Thank you guys. And basically, that's just about the name.
So you actually had to fight to get the name. No giving up, I like that.
I've been listening to a gentleman speak the whole evening, and they're probably panicking, wondering what I'm going to say. And they did probably expect me to be here. I work for Stanbic Bank. I'm the head of marketing at Stanbic Bank. And the whole evening they've been talking very illusionary about this bank that they do a lot of work. And for me, that just tells you the level of discretion and the level of humbleness these gentlemen have. They will not say anything without clearing with you first. So I've been sitting here very quiet and wondering why, and then saying the name of the bank. So for me, it just tells you the level of professionalism and the level of dedication they have to their work. And just want to say, gentlemen, congratulations, thank you very much. I'm very impressed. I'm actually surprised you haven't said the name, because it will actually get you more business. So you have my permission, you can actually use the name. Secondly, the level of work these gentlemen do and their team is exceptional. One of the biggest events we had last year was the Stanbic Jazz Festival, where we brought in Elkru, Mikasa, Oliver Mtukuzi. And I can guarantee you, anybody who came to that event, from the screen imagery that you saw on the large screens that we had at the event, to the pictures that you saw on social media, to some of the imagery that you saw in the newspapers, everything was covered by this organization. So it gives you an indication of how much we trust them. We put a lot of money in, and we invest significantly in events of that nature. We trust them to produce it. We trust them to make sure that it's at the highest quality. So speaking on behalf of the bank, a bank which supports the single largest SME customer base in the country, I can guarantee you that this is a true testimony of what Zambian entrepreneurship should be. We encourage them and we look forward to working with them in the future. Thank you, gentlemen.
My name is Lumonga, and this is my colleague Chico. We're a baby company. I want Fortress to see us. We are a baby company called Hashtag. We just started. We are looking to get into styling and makeup and what's so not on the Zambian industry. Stanbic, we want a loan, just to let you know. Fortress, we've been impressed with your work for over a period of time. I'm proud to say Fortress is a Zambian company. Even KwaBazungu, I can click on my laptop and say, look, this is a Zambian company. I'm not ashamed of you guys. And I think every one of us should, you know, fly the Zambian flag high with Fortress. We've been looking for mentors. I think we found them today. So we have a request, actually, not even a question. Can you guys mentor us? We are willing to work for free in the beginning on styling projects, makeup projects, but we want to tag along, you know, like your minions, so that we learn how business is done. We want to enter the fortress through the back door and leave through the front door. So that That's all we are asking for. We are hashtag. Their name, when fortress is around, you shouldn't be afraid of anything. Now imagine, when hashtag is around, your style is on fleek, then your pictures are on fleek. What's better than that? We're hashtag, good evening.
We're the longest guys to ever provide media services to Stanley. We're getting into our second year now. We ran a very successful year, and thanks to Perry and his belief in us, we met him once and we told him we could do this, and he said, okay guys, do this for me, and we did it, and we're very happy that he's here to support us. We're happy that our bank is here to support us. We bank with Stanley. What's interesting about hashtag is you use the correct terminology, media. Because we do a lot of mentorships. I think a lot of you guys know the photography company called Quitu. Yes, Quitu is, I can gladly say, it's one of our boys. He's still around. We gave him what he needed. We're not afraid to give a photographer a platform and advice and knowledge on how to run and go set up his own photography business. That is our place, and if you come to Fortress, you will find that there's a lot of young people, and we have a few more minions. There's a minion over there. And we basically would like to invest in others who are starting up, who are coming behind us. And so I think without even discussing it with Eddie, it's something that we could, I would say, come over to the office, we sit down and structure it, because you need to get something out of it. You need to understand something. It has to be planned. We have to be deliberate in everything that we do. We're going to do a shoot. We have to know why we're doing that shoot. If we're going to have you minion, you have to understand what your role is and what you need to learn, because that's the only way you're going to learn. Otherwise, everything is going to be in vain.
Before you partnered with us on projects, this is something that we have actually done a lot over the past couple of years. We do seek out creatives in different aspects of the industry, in terms of styling, makeup artists, and we do projects with them. So it's something that I think people are comfortable saying, like, yes. Even if we have an idea, we said no, Fortress, I think if you did a shoot like this, it would work out, so can we try it out? So something that you can actually, once we have a sit down, that we could actually do, and we are 100% fine with it.
Okay, so
but one more thing, you need to be, again, willing and ready to put in all the work and everything that will be required, and that's the one thing that we've had some unions who come in and they feel they can not get about this just by standing there. This is a lot of work which you have to put in at every given time that it's required.
Okay, so as we come to the end of the interview, last piece of advice you'd give to someone who's starting up, being a young startup company that has done so well, and if a bank like Stanbic can attest to that, I mean, yeah, living testimony, and that's really encouraging. So, a piece of advice to someone who's starting up?
I guess the most cliche one will always be get your education right. Because, yeah, without education, your thinking is a bit limited. Education, I believe, helps open up your minds, opens you up, and you see things differently. So for starters, try get your education right. Don't just leave school and say, no, I'm gonna start a business for degree 12. So try get further education to expand your thinking. Secondly, read a lot. Read as much as possible. What I do almost on a daily basis, I go on my phone, I go on Flipboard, I've subscribed to a lot of different magazines and as well as writers. And every day, every night before I sleep, I scroll through articles and see what's happening in the industry, which new cameras are out there, what new editing techniques are out there, or who's doing what movies being made, how did they like this movie. So do a lot of reading and a lot of research. For example, just last month, I was sharing with Maliq, like, look at how they were lighting James Bond. And did you know in this scene they actually had 150 likes? So stuff like that just have an interest in your field beyond your actual work, beyond what you're doing already, beyond your company. Just go further. And then finally, take it one step at a time. Just one day at a time. One step every day. And you get better.
Awesome, Malik.
I don't know which tips to bring out. I can have a million of them.
The one important one that is so important.
I think the one that I would bring out, I regret I gave him the mic first. Yeah, but the one thing that I would like every entrepreneur to know is having interacted with different levels of entrepreneurs at a really high level in our field, as well as different fields, the one thing that all of them have had in common with us is the fact that at any given point it does get real out there. It does get tough. When stuff start falling on your head, it can get you discouraged, it can get you messed up, it can get you wanting to quit. The one thing that you need to do is at that particular point, you need to make sure you tease out the one thing that you know this is what is going to work and stick to that, then it is going to work. It's what we've done. It's what that would be my word of encouragement to say, make sure you know what you're doing and why you're doing it and stick to it. Then eventually it will work out. I think if you put in everything towards what you're doing, you will be able to grow, you know, in a short period of time. We've only been around for almost two years. Our 2 years is next month, February. And I think we've had significant growth. And so I think when you are focused like that, you will grow to where you need to grow. And don't listen a lot to the thing. And somebody says say that if you're going towards a destination, and say you're going to the Copper Belt, along the way you're in a bus, and there's all these dogs barking at Chisamba, at Kawe, and whatnot. You don't stop to throw stones at them. But the driver doesn't stop to say, hey, Kusek. No, he keeps driving until you get to Kitwe. And so, yeah, there'll be a lot of dogs barking. Make sure you don't pay attention to them. I say that because that's the negative side. Along the way, you find a lot of positive people who help you embrace them. Yeah, the bad ones just... It was nice to meet you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Malik. Thank you, Edwin, for keeping it real. We've learned so much from your partnership. I love the name Fortress Media. And one thing I must make mention is they're our sponsors. They always produce our videos for Startup Grind. So big up to them, and thank you for having you here.